Hi, my name is Dr. Mary Casey Jacob. I'm the psychologist at the Center for Advanced Reproductive Services. I'm what's called a health psychologist or a medical psychologist, which means I have all the training that any psychologist would have, but my work is always focused on helping people navigate some kind of a healthcare or medical system when their bodies are letting them down. At the center, I do a range of different kinds of work. Sometimes I help people get over needle phobias or quit smoking. I help people cope with the sadness of their infertility. I help people decide what to do, especially if you're a member of a couple and the two of you are not exactly on the same page. In this tape, what I'd like to do is help you think about in vitro fertilization. You have seen the physician talk about the medical side of this process, what the different steps in the IVF recipe are. And I want to talk with you about what it's like to go through the process, to experience it, so that you can try to prepare yourselves as well as possible. I'm going to start by talking about the medications. And I know that some of you may have used these injectable medications before, but I'm going to ask you to hang in there because I'll get to other topics that I bet will be new for you. For those of you, however, who have never used the injectable fertility medications, thinking about the use of those hormones can often be one source of anxiety as people wait to get going with their IVF. So I want to tell you what it's like. And I think the good news is that on the injectable medications, we rarely see dramatic mood or behavioral side effects. Unlike some other medications that we use for other purposes, for these medications, for almost all of you, it's going to fall well within the tolerable range. However, there are some predictable side effects that many of you will experience, and I want to help you know what to expect. The first thing is that if you're going to take one of the medications that shuts you down hormonally at the beginning of your cycle, you might experience hot flashes. These medications are sort of putting you in a false menopause temporarily, and hot flashes are one of the most common side effects of that. So you might experience hot flashes, about half of you will, and they can range from the mild end where you just feel warm when nobody else feels warm and you spend a lot of time saying to other people, is it hot in here? And they look at you and say, no, I'm good. And that's the mild end. And then the more dramatic end is where you can have these really out of the blue drenching sweats. They don't last long, maybe 30 or 40 seconds, but they're really annoying. And if they happen when you're sleeping, you know, you might want to keep a pile of dry t-shirts by the side of the bed so you can just change easily. But half of you will experience some of these, and usually at the milder end, and the other half of you are unlikely to experience hot flashes. Whether or not you experience hot flashes tells us nothing about how the medication is working. It's really just the luck of the draw whether you experience these or not, and they'll go away when you're finished using the medication. On the doses that we use for IVF, we do not see mood changes on these drugs that shut you down hormonally. When we use these same drugs for other purposes in much larger doses, we do sometimes see mood changes, so you may have heard about that. But on the doses we use for IVF, very, very, very unlikely to happen. Now, when you move on to the medications that you take to stimulate your ovaries to produce multiple mature eggs, here's what we see. About half of you will feel emotionally and behaviorally completely normal. And if I checked with those who love you, they would say, yep, she seems like herself. Now, the funny thing about this is if you're lucky enough to be in the group with no side effects, it can be a little disconcerting. When you are injecting yourself with hormones every day, you kind of expect to feel hormonal. And if you don't, it can make you wonder if the medication is working. But really, half of you will just be fine, and the medication will be working. Then a very small group of you, maybe 10% of you, are gonna feel better than you have ever felt in your entire lives. You're gonna think, I like this stuff. And you're just gonna have this sense of well-being that's a little bit hard to describe. And then 40% of you are going to experience some mood changes. And it's not what I would call big fat mood swings. We all know what those are, or we think we know what they are, where you have moods that make no sense for the moment or for what's going on in your life right then. We rarely see that on the IVF drugs. Maybe one or two people in 1,000 will have a big fat mood swing. What we see instead for about 40% of you is what I would call a magnification of a normal mood. So the flavor of the mood makes perfect sense for the moment. You would always feel a little bit sensitive in this situation or a little bit irritated in this situation, or you might always get a chuckle out of this situation. But what you find is that your reaction is slightly exaggerated. And it really is slight, which is one of the reasons I like to talk to all of you about this, because I think if you're injecting yourself every day with hormones and you have a big fat mood swing, it's easier to make sense of it. When you have these really subtle changes, you're more likely to think, what is the matter with me? Or what is the matter with her? Or what have I done now? It's more likely to be thought of as situational, but it's not. So one of the coping suggestions I want to make for you, I'm going to sprinkle my talk with coping suggestions. One of them is, as you go through IVF, I want you to blame everything on the drugs and focus on coping with what happens as opposed to overanalyzing or overdiagnosing. But definitely a number of you will feel just a little emotionally wobbly. And it's usually not very dramatic. It's the kind of thing that your partner, if you have one, or your mom or your best friend might notice. But other people you work with, strangers at the grocery store, it's not the kind of thing that takes up a lot of space or that other people will notice. So you could have this mood magnification. Also, on the medications that you take to stimulate your ovaries to produce multiple mature eggs, a small number of you, maybe 10% of you, are going to say you feel kind of like a space cadet. You're going to find that your attention wanders, that it's a little bit harder than usual to make everyday decisions like what to wear or what to eat. We do not have people finding it so difficult to pay attention that they make mistakes or that they're a danger to themselves or others in their work. So this isn't something that worries us, but it can be, again, disconcerting if you don't know. I want you to have me in your heads as you go through this cycle and so that you can say, oh yeah, she said that might happen. So that's about 10%, and again, it goes away. All of these things go away when you're finished using these medications. Then after your embryo transfer, you're going to be asked to use progesterone for a period of time. And most of you will experience no mood or behavioral changes as a result of the progesterone, but a few of you will, because progesterone is actually a natural depressant. And it's very rare that we see the progesterone that we use cause people to feel depressed, very rare. What we see instead for a small number of you is that the range of your mood, the highs and the lows, gets leveled down so that you don't have as much excitement about some things or as much sadness about something. So you might feel emotionally just a little bit flat. And this can also be very disconcerting, particularly if you get a positive pregnancy test and your response is kind of like, oh, that's good, right, honey? Because you're really planning on being thrilled, I think. But for some people who have this side effect to the medication, your response might be flat. And that doesn't worry us. It will go away when your pregnancy starts making its own progesterone and you can stop using the progesterone supplements. And again, that's a very small minority of you that will experience that. So when we look at this all together, we can say that some of you will definitely know that you're taking these hormones and you will feel some changes, and those who are close to you will be able to tell there are some changes. But it's really rare that a woman will say, this was torture and I couldn't do this again. So that's the good news, because I think some of you are expecting it to be bad. And the information I'm giving you applies whether or not you have a history of premenstrual changes with significant mood changes, whether or not you had significant side effects if you took Clomid. That's a completely different kind of medication and doesn't tell us how you will respond to these injectable medications. And it doesn't matter whether you have a history of a major mood problem like depression or anxiety. None of those things predict for us who will have these side effects to these medications. I've been the psychologist on the team at the center since 1991, and I am as clueless today about who will have these responses as I was in my first year on the job. I really have not learned anything that helps me predict. So if you're a worrier, if you're somebody who spends a lot of time thinking, I bet it will be terrible, and what if it's terrible, I want to suggest to you that you do whatever you can to interrupt that kind of thinking. So this is another coping suggestion. interrupt that kind of thinking if you can, because there's no way for you to know in advance if you're going to have these side effects, and only a minority do, and they're not usually terrible. So this is not a place to put much attention in the weeks that lead up to your IVF. Now, also related to the medications is the whole injection thing. And I want to say a number of things to you about needing to do these injections at home or on the job or wherever you are when it's time. The first thing is that if we thought you would screw it up, we wouldn't let you do it. We have been training people up to do these kinds of things at home for decades, as have all fertility programs. And you probably all know somebody who does injections at home, whether it's for diabetes or allergies or possibly fertility treatments. So this is common and it's doable, and we will help you prepare for it. Most of you will get your training for this online, but if you need a personal sort of touch, if you wanted to talk it through with your nurse after you did the online training, that's always a possibility for you. But as you think about getting ready for the injections, again, from a coping perspective, I want you to think about a couple of different things. First, I want you to recognize that deciding who is going to give the injections is a choice. I'm aware that we tend to talk to our patients as if we get to decide, and as if we have an expectation that the woman attempting to conceive will give herself the small subcutaneous injections that come before the egg retrieval, and that partners or other family members will give progesterone injections that follow the embryo transfer. But it's a choice, and there's many different ways of thinking about the choice. So first of all, for example, we could talk about how you feel about needles. Are you scared of needles? There are people who are terrified of needles. There are people who are just a little anxious about needles. And then there are people who don't care about needles. So if you're terrified, if you are phobic of needles, I want you to ask for my help before you do your cycle. I always say, I tell people about my husband. My husband, Mike, was a macho kind of guy. He was a New England powerlifting champion, but he had to close his eyes if somebody picked up a needle in his presence, even if it was on television. He would say, "Tell me when it's over and I'll open my eyes." So if you're like Mike, if you're really scared of needles, I want you to ask for help. It's a very treatable condition, but I need to be able to work with you for, you know, 2 or 3 weeks at least before you do your cycle in order to be effective. And then we will help you get through it. Now, if you are in that middle group where you feel anxious about needles, but you're always able to make yourself do what you need to do, what you're going to find by the end of your IVF, where you have needles every day, is that you're hardly going to be able to remember what you were worried about. And this is because the number one most effective treatment for any kind of fear or phobia or this kind of fearful anxiety is what we call exposure therapy. So just by virtue of doing it every day, your body stops listening to your brain because your body has figured out there is no crisis going on here. And it stops that anxious response. So by the end of your IVF, you're pretty much going to be over this. Now, in terms of deciding who's going to do the injections, you might think about who's scared and who's not scared, but there are other things to think about too. Commonly, our patients think, and now I'm speaking about the woman who's trying to conceive, commonly they think, "I should do those small injections unless I'm unable to." But I would say to you, you know, it depends. Is one of you, if you're doing this with a partner, is one of you way more of a control freak than the other? Maybe that person needs to do it. Is your mom or your best friend a nurse who could easily help you? That would be okay too. If you're doing this with a partner again, have you been looking for a way to feel like we're making a baby together when so much of what we do with you has you in different rooms? Going through this together might be a psychologically helpful thing for you, where one of you prepares the medication, the other gives the injections, but somehow you're doing it together. It's a little piece of time each day that you spend together. So there's lots of different ways of thinking about this. And when I talk with our patients about coping and how to be good copers, one of the things I always want to point out is that good copers really focus their attention on trying to make choices where they actually get a vote, where you have power and authority. And this is one of those areas. You get to choose who's going to do your injections. And choosing it will help you feel a little bit more in charge of things. And that's helpful because so much of the experience of infertility is an experience of feeling out of control, of not being able to control something that you feel like you should be able to control. And of course, on the one hand, I would say to you, if you don't have any children now, just wait, because if we're successful in helping you have kids, you're never going to feel in control again. However, we all want to feel a little bit in control, and making choices where we can is one way to do that. So take some time to think about who should do the injections, and you will find that very helpful. You will find that other patients are helpful in helping you figure out how to cope and manage the injections. There's lots of little hints flying around our offices. The nurses are very helpful. Don't be afraid to ask questions, and we will help you get through it. I also want to remind you, as you're getting ready to do your first injection ever, if you're completely new to this, you're going to be home and we're not going to be with you, but we always have somebody on call in an emergency. And different kinds of medical practices define emergencies in different ways. But for us, in fertility land, if we have said, take this shot at 9 o'clock tonight, and you're having trouble making it happen, that's kind of an emergency. So you just call into our offices. There's always somebody who can talk you through it. And most of you are never gonna need that, but I want you to know that that help is there just in case. So you feel like you have a little bit of a backup available if you need it. So that's it for medications and injections, and I hope you'll take any questions you have to your doctor or nurse, or feel free to call me if you feel that I can be helpful. And now I'd like to completely switch gears and talk about the topic of stress and fertility. Almost certainly, if you have been trying to conceive for a while, and if you've shared with anybody else that you've been trying to conceive for a while, you've discovered that you have a range of people in your life who say things that are not helpful to you, like, it'll happen, you're trying too hard, relax, adopt and you'll get pregnant. There's all these things people say, and I know you've heard them if other people are aware that you've been trying, and especially if they're aware that you are sad. Now, the first thing I would say to you is, if you're honest with yourself, you know that many of you have said these things to other people before you started trying to conceive yourself. We believe these things in our culture. We think they're well-known facts. But what is the evidence for that? What is the evidence that stress has an impact on fertility? I told you at the beginning of this conversation that I'm a medical psychologist, and so we are the group of psychologists that has really pioneered looking at things like the impact of stress on the body. One of the things we've learned is that in order to do useful research, we have to divide stress into at least two categories. And one category are big, life-threatening, out-of-the-blue, scary stressors, like natural disasters, or being assaulted, or a sudden death in the family, or your house burns down, or any of these things could happen to somebody you care about, and they can feel just as stressful. So that's one category of stressors. The other category is the day in and day out, the stuff that I refer to as perfectly predictable things. You hate your job, but the insurance will pay for your IVF. You feel like everybody's pregnant but you. You know that your mom is once again going to say something that's well-intentioned but unhelpful. There's all these things that happen around us and happen with regularity, and some may have to do with your fertility challenges and some may not. But they are perfectly predictable things. In my practice, we've started referring to these as PPTs. So the perfectly predictable things are the kinds of stressors that people are thinking about when they say, you've got to relax, you're trying too hard, it won't work if you're too stressed out. But what's the evidence? So in the world of just health and medicine, we have learned that PPTs, perfectly predictable things, do have an impact on some kinds of health variables. For example, if you are diabetic, your PPTs are going to be somewhat predictive of what your blood sugar levels are in the coming days, in addition to what you're doing with your medication, your diet, and your exercise. In the world of fertility, the big out-of-the-blue, dramatic, and scary stressors can have an impact. So for example, if something terrible happens in your life, if you're a man, it might kill off your current crop of sperm, even though you're perfectly capable of making a new batch. If you're a woman, it might cause you to ovulate early or late, even though your body will fix itself within a cycle or two. But in the world of fertility, we have not been able to show that PPTs have an impact on whether you will conceive and stay pregnant. And I know that when I say this to you, it's the opposite of what you might read in a lot of the lay literature. There's tons of stuff that's been written in the last decade probably about mind-body medicine and its importance in fertility. But the research evidence is really quite bad. For every study you might be able to show me that suggests there is a link, I can show you several that say the opposite. And in particular, we haven't been able to reproduce any of the studies that do show a link. And I want to call your attention to the fact that when people talk about stress and fertility, and I even hear physicians sometimes talking about it, so these are really common beliefs. When people talk about stress and fertility, they talk about it like it's a well-known fact, like we are tripping over the evidence for this. It makes me think of how we do trip over the evidence, for example, around smoking and lung disease. We know that not everybody gets lung disease when they smoke, but at this point, the evidence is so overwhelming that most of you have accepted that you have an increased risk for lung disease if you smoke or if somebody you love smokes, because the results are quite common. Infertility and stress gets talked about in the same way, but the evidence is not there in the same way. And if you stop and think about it, you know that there's counter evidence in your everyday world too. How often have you felt grief or anger when you hear about somebody getting pregnant again, who's in a circumstance where they can't take good care of the baby when it's in the uterus, and they can't take good care of the child after it's born? They live incredibly stressful lives, or they're living on the street, or they use drugs or alcohol, and yet it can seem sometimes like these folks are popping out babies like there's no tomorrow. So we know that there is not a simple relationship between stress and fertility. And I really wish there was. If we thought that helping you manage your stress well would help you conceive and carry, then guess who you'd all be coming to see before you did your IVF cycle? Me, or somebody like me. Because we can help you cope with your stress, and I'm happy to help you cope with your stress. But I don't have any evidence that it will help you get pregnant. I think being a good coper helps you feel better, be happier, be nice to your partners and your other loved ones, make good decisions, have fun occasionally. But I don't think it gets you pregnant or keeps you pregnant. So if this has been a worry for you, I want you to listen to what I'm saying and consider the possibility that what's being written for the lay public is not based on good data. Similarly, I hear our patients talking about attitude. Almost every week I have a couple in my office where one is saying to the other, you know, there's no point in doing this if you're going to be so pessimistic about it. It's not going to work unless you're optimistic. And in health psychology, we have studied optimism and pessimism to see what their impacts are on health and on the body, and they do have some impacts. For example, if you are a lifelong, highly skilled pessimist, you're a little bit more likely than others to suffer depression at some point in your life. So being an optimist is a buffer against things like depression. So it's useful. But we have not been able to show that it has an impact on fertility, again. The only time that I worry about pessimism is if your attitude is so rotten that you won't follow directions either. But if you can have a rotten attitude and follow directions, I think your chance of conceiving and carrying is really the same as somebody who's all chirpy and optimistic all the time. And I know that some of you who are not lifelong pessimists have become kind of pessimistic about your fertility challenges. Some of you feel that you're protecting yourselves by keeping your expectations low and not getting your hopes up too high. So on the one hand, I would say to you, it's not clear to me that it works that way, because it seems to me that everybody in our programs who doesn't conceive is equally sad. But on the other hand, I would say, if that's what you're doing to protect yourself, and if it comforts you in the short term to have lower expectations, we're not worried about that. We don't think it will impact your chances of success. So in terms of stress and fertility, if you want help coping with stress and changing how you respond to the things that are happening in your life, somebody like me can be very helpful with that. Or we could suggest readings that might be helpful to you. But if you're worried about whether you have to get a total grip on that before you do your IVF, I would say no, you don't. We can help you regardless. Now, let me make a couple of other suggestions about areas where you get to choose things as you go through your IVF, other ways of feeling a little bit more in control and a little bit more like you can plan pieces of your IVF. So one thing is to think about what you have chosen to do so far, about telling or not telling others about your fertility challenges. And if you're doing this with a partner, you need to disclose to each other those choices that you've made. And in my experience, couples don't always know what the other has done. So you might need to have an actual frank conversation about this. And in our experience, when we talk to a whole pile of patients together, we know there are some people who have told nobody that they're trying to conceive or that they're sad. And that might be because you're just private about everything. It might be because sometimes people feel shame or confusion when their bodies are letting them down. It might be because trying to conceive has to do with sex for many of you, and that's too personal and too uncomfortable to talk with others about. It may be because of beliefs or attitudes in your culture or community about fertility. So there's lots of reasons why people choose total privacy. But the downside, the unexpected downside for people who choose total privacy, is that nobody knows that you're sad. People are assuming that you are child-free by choice. They are more likely to say things in your presence that are hurtful and incorrect. So sometimes choosing total privacy ends up being an unexpected burden. And you could choose to change that. And I'll make a suggestion in a minute. Now, some of you are at the other end of the spectrum where you've told everybody what you're going through because you have nothing to hide and you commonly discuss the challenging things that are happening in your life and you're just an open person. But in the course of doing that, you may have discovered that the world is full of knuckleheads who say things that are not helpful. And some of them are loving knuckleheads who are trying really hard to be helpful, but they're getting it wrong. And some of them are self-absorbed knuckleheads who are just saying what comforts them as they observe the pain that you're experiencing. So you also could slightly modify things if you feel it would be helpful to you. I want to emphasize there's no right or wrong here in terms of telling and not telling. You should do what helps you, what comforts you, and what soothes you. But I want to point out that for many people, what those things are changes as our lives change. So what was helpful and comforting and soothing in the first 6 months of your attempts to conceive might be different if you're 2 years in now or 3 years in. So it's always worth stopping and saying, how's it working for us the way that we're doing it? And do I want to modify anything? Now, if you've been totally private, and you are private, but you know what I mean about how it can end up being a little bit of a burden, the suggestion I have for you is to let this much information, I call it letting the tip of the tail of the cat out of the bag. And what that means is the next time somebody says, so when are you going to have kids? You've been married a long time, or whatever it is that people are saying to you. Instead of deflecting the conversation, which is probably what you've done in the past, you might just look them in the eye and say, I wish I knew. We've been trying for a long time. It's not going well. It's painful and private, and I don't want to talk about it. But if you're wondering why sometimes we seem sad or why I sent a gift to the baby shower instead of attending, it's really because of this. We are just struggling. So all prayers and fertile thoughts are welcome, but I don't want to talk about it. Now, even if you say, I don't want to talk about it, two or three times in that little speech, half of the people you say this to are still going to ask a question. And you're just going to have to look them in the eye again and say, no, seriously. Painful, private, don't want to talk about it. So you don't have to talk about your diagnosis or how long it's been or what treatments you've tried or who holds the diagnosis. You just allow as how, yeah, you'd like to be a parent and you're working on it and it's really hard. And that's what you share. So consider that if you feel it would be helpful, comforting, and take some kind of pressure off. Now, if you're at the other end of the spectrum and everybody knows what you're going through and everybody knows you're about to do IVF, but you wish they didn't, what are your choices? I think there are two main strategies for pulling back and getting a little bit of privacy. I mean, we don't yet know any way of just erasing people's memories, so we can't do that. But what can you do? Well, if you have people in your life who really love you and who really want to help, what you could do is tell them what would be helpful. You could say to them, I'm so grateful that you've been there for us as we've gone through this attempt to have children. And in the beginning, it was incredibly helpful to be able to talk to you and to know that you were there to listen whenever I needed that. But now we're sick to death of talking about it. And we're going to sort of go in our caves now. We're going to be more private about the attempts that we have coming up. You know we will tell you if we have good news and when it's time to celebrate. But the way that you can be helpful to me now is if you would do, and you have to tell them what it is. Do you want them to ask how it's going? Do you want them to never mention infertility unless you do? Do you want them to just focus on asking you how your job is going or compliment your dress or ask about your mother? Tell them what to do. It almost never works for us to just say to people, please don't do that. We have to give them something else to do instead if they're really trying to be helpful. And most of us, and probably you too, what we do when we're trying to be helpful is what would be helpful to us. And that's only going to be helpful to some people. So if you want them to do something else, you have to figure out what it is and then tell them. Now, I know that many of you also have people in your lives who are asking a lot of questions and ending up being kind of intrusive, and they're not going to listen to you if you ask them to do something else. So what do you do? Well, I think what you do is you stop sharing so much information. And this is a skill, if you will allow me to do a gross generalization for a minute. This is a skill that many men have and few women have. I have three brothers. They are really good at not answering questions. You say to them, where are you going? They say, out. When will you be back? This afternoon. If I ask one of my three sisters that very same question, they talk about, well, I'm going to go here and I'm going to go there, but first I have to change my clothes. And we're just used to just answering questions. And I want to suggest to you that a really good life skill is to not answer questions. We don't want to necessarily get mad at the people who ask them, but we want to give ourselves permission not to answer them. And that is true no matter who's asking. For example, some of you will listen to me say this and you'll say, yeah, I could do that at work. I could stop answering all those questions at work. But when my mother asks, but I would say to you, nope, your mom doesn't get this information either unless it's helpful, comforting, and soothing to talk to her. If you were trying to get pregnant what I call the old-fashioned way, most of you would not be ringing up your mom saying, Mom, I peed on a stick today. It's ovulation day. I called Tom. He's on his way home. Most of you would not do that. You would take some privacy for yourselves. And I would say to you that even with IVF, you have the choice of taking privacy for yourself. When people say, so when are you doing your IVF? Just shrug and say, I don't know yet. When they say, when is your egg retrieval? Just say, you know, if my ovaries were acting in a predictable way, I wouldn't even be doing IVF. I don't know. Or you can just completely divert people. Sometimes you can just literally not answer a question and start a different conversation. Most of us would rather talk about ourselves than you anyway. So if I ask you, when's your IVF? And you respond by saying, I love that top. Where did you get it? I'm going to be off and running on the clothing conversation, and you will have diverted me. So think about being intentional about the information you share. If it helps you, if it comforts you, if it soothes you to tell all this information, keep telling it. But if you have wondered how to get some privacy back, these are a couple of suggestions. In particular, I want you to think about how many people you want in the know about when your pregnancy test results are going to be back. How many people do you want to have to report to on the day, whether the news is positive or negative? Think about, you know, taking a piece of privacy back as a way of getting some control over that. Now, another area where you get a choice is pregnancy test day. For those of you who haven't done cycles with us yet, let me tell you how it works. You're going to come in that morning and you're going to give blood for a pregnancy test. And the results come back usually sometimes mid-morning, maybe late morning. It depends a little bit what else the lab has to do that day and how many of you are being tested. Now, the first PPT I want you to prepare for in terms of pregnancy test day is that almost certainly the call you get will be from your nurse and not from your doctor. And I know that many of you would prefer that it come from your doctor, but the results become available when the doctors are not available, and we know you want the results as soon as you can get them. So the calls are going to be made by the nurses. And I want you to think about where they should call, who they should call, and can they leave a message. We are all so wired these days that we have too many devices, too many numbers. And if you leave it entirely up to your nurse to decide where to call, what are the chances she's going to pick what you wish she would have picked? So first of all, if you're doing this with a partner, I want you to talk seriously about who should get the call. In my experience, the woman who's attempting to conceive assumes that she should get the call because she's the patient in a most traditional sense. And some of you want to get the call, but some of you actually would love for your partners to get the call, but it never occurred to you to ask. Or you think your partner is too busy or too this or too that. I'm asking you, have this conversation. What would help you? What would comfort you? And when you come in that morning, you could come with a piece of paper with your request on it. It could say, please call this person at this number, and get them to staple it to your paperwork so that they have it in front of them when the results come back. You could say, for example, call this number and leave a message, or call this number, I'll be waiting for your call, or call this number, but could you do it after 2 o'clock because we're both going to leave work early and try to be home together to get the result. So think about how you could structure this day so that you don't jump out of your skin every time somebody's device vibrates or dings in your vicinity. You know, have a little control over which device is it going to be and around when, if possible. What are the other ways you can take some control? I think you could put some thought into how you're going to get out of work if you work in the mornings. How are you going to get out of work for all the ultrasounds and blood work that are necessary? So the woman who's trying to conceive is going to be coming to see us every second or third day during the period when she's stimulating her ovaries to produce multiple mature eggs. And partners, we welcome you to come to those appointments, but it's not required. If you work between the hours of 7 and 10, this means it's going to interfere with your work. So how are you going to manage this? It's very much my recommendation that you have a plan and that you work out the plan before you start your cycle. Think about whether you're sharing with people at work that you're attempting to conceive or not sharing. If you are attempting to conceive, then you can share that during this period of time, and the nurses will give you the window during which this might occur. During a particular period of time, I'm going to need to be late to work every couple of days, and I'll only know a day or two in advance when that's going to be. So how can we work this out? Can I come in late? Can I work through lunch? Who can cover for me? Talk it through in advance so that you have less stress around this particular issue. If you're very private and you have no intention of telling people at work that you're trying to conceive, you have to approach it in a different way, but I still recommend that you work something out in advance and that you stay as close to the truth as possible, because most of us are lousy liars, first of all, and in the absence of telling people something, they will make up a story about what you're up to. That's just human nature. So if you're going to be private about things, you could, for example, talk to your boss to say, I'm just going to have some medical tests done during this couple week period, and they're mostly going to be in the morning, so how can I work it out to come in late? And if your boss says, oh, what's the matter? You just say, it's really private, I'm not going to talk about it, but it's medical. And if you work in a place that would require a doctor's note for this kind of thing, we can give you a generic note that just says you had an appointment at the center or at the health center. Some of you are thinking, well, in order to stay really private, I'm going to take a half a day off, or I'm going to use my personal time, if you're lucky enough to have it. And certainly that's an option, but for most of you, you'd love to have all that time available to you when you conceive, if we're able to help you conceive. So the more you can work this out at the front end without taking official time, the more it might benefit you at the back end. But however you look at it, we really recommend that you have a plan. And some of you are going to say, well, why can't I have my ultrasound or blood work in the afternoon? That would be so much more convenient for me. And we're going to say, we're sorry, but you can't. It is quite regimented, and that's really a quality control process more than anything else. We know that you want us to be as careful as possible in how we do things. And so ultrasounds and blood work are first thing in the morning. That allows the results to be back by lunchtime, when your physician, your team, and the other physicians all put their brains together on your behalf to say, how's she doing? Does she need more medicine, less medicine? Are we ready to trigger for the retrieval? So we want the results back, and we also need you to take your shots and have your testing at roughly the same times each day, so we get similar kinds of results based on the medications that you're taking. So it's not a flexible process, and we know that it creates hardship for some of you, but it's not just rigidness on our part. There's really an important reason for the process, because we want to do our best job for you. One final area where you might be able to modify your coping, if that's of interest to you, is to think about how you have talked about your fertility challenges within your partnership, if you're doing this with a partner. It's very common in relationships, whether they are gay or straight relationships, very common that one person's a talker and the other is not. Very commonly, the talker is a woman, but not always. In my marriage, my husband was the talker, and I would get home from work and say, I'm talked out, so not for me, thanks. So it's, you know, we have to be careful with the stereotypes again, but very common that there's a talker and a non-talker. And this can be a cause of stress within the relationship, because when talkers are going through stressful things, they often want to talk about it a lot. And when non-talkers are going through stressful things, it's painful to talk about it a lot. So what can you do about that if you have that kind of a difference of approach in your household? So the first thing is, I would ask you to recognize that you're both doing your best to cope with the stress and the challenge of fertility, infertility. If you're the talker, you're using muscles from the neck up. And if you're a non-talker, you're probably using muscles from the neck down. Non-talkers commonly work harder, longer hours, mow the lawn, fix things, play video games. They're not doing nothing, but it's not talking. Now, the challenge with these two different kinds of coping is that talkers look at non-talkers and think, you don't care, you're not upset, I'm in this all by myself. And non-talkers look at talkers and think, oh my God, if I were acting like that, I would be totally at the end of my rope. And so we often, again, we interpret each other's behavior in terms of what it would mean if we were doing it. So the first thing I'm trying to do is say to you, I think they're both normal. They both work for people, so that's okay. But within a relationship, how do you accommodate each other? One suggestion I have, which sounds totally artificial and works really well, is that you agree to talk a couple times a week and agree not to talk the rest of the time about fertility, unless you've had a doctor's appointment, and then you always get to report. So you might, in general, set up a 30-minute period twice a week, you know, Sunday breakfast, Wednesday dinner, something like that. And the non-talker agrees to talk. No TV, no newspaper, eye contact, I'm in it with you for 30 minutes. And if you're the talker, first of all, what you're going to find is that you don't need to talk about this all the time. You just really need your partner's full attention sometimes. And when you have that, you have less of a need to talk at other times. But also, you'll find that even if you feel like talking at other times, you're able to wait because you know that you're going to have your partner's full attention soon. So if you have things you want to talk about, but it's not a day for talking, I'd encourage you to just make a few notes about the things you want to make sure to discuss, and then put it aside for the next time you've agreed to meet and talk. Now, this is just a suggestion, and as I say, I know it sounds crazy, but it will work really well for many of you. And if you try it and it doesn't work well, then don't do it again. Everything I'm offering you are just suggestions that will work for some of you and not for all of you. So you see what will work for you. There's loads of other kinds of things you can do to help yourself cope well. I can give you reading suggestions if you're interested. People like me can help you talk through some of these strategies. But the main thing is to sort of adopt a habit of saying to yourself regularly, is what I'm doing comforting me or agitating me? We can often get so caught up in feeling right about things that we don't notice that when we focus on those things, we feel bad. A perfect example is when you may feel critical of the way others have talked to you about your fertility, and you might feel totally annoyed about that. But if you focus on that, if you mull that over, if you rehearse that thought, you're the one that's suffering, not the other person. So finding ways to put that aside can be very helpful, even though you're right. One of the phrases I use with many of our patients is, you know, just because it's right doesn't mean it's helpful. So what I want you to focus on is what's helpful to you. So those are just some ideas about how to cope and get your heads ready for going through IVF. And now what I want to do is talk just a little bit about the areas of your IVF treatment plan that you actually need to negotiate with your physician. So your physician has talked with you about all the different steps and the areas where decisions have to be made. And I want to highlight for you where your input is critical, because you have to tell us what your ethics are, your spiritual beliefs, your financial abilities, and what I always refer to as the heebie-jeebie factor. For some people, pushing Mother Nature too far occurs at a certain point, and you have to tell us what those things are. So here are the decision points you need to talk through with your physician, and ideally, you have a really good strategy in place before you start your cycle, because your brains are going to be working better now than they are when you're in the stress of your cycle. So number one is, what do we do with the eggs that you produce? We're going to stimulate your ovaries. We're going to collect all the eggs you make, because that's the best thing for you. If you are a young woman in your 20s or early 30s, that might mean a dozen or two dozen eggs. If you're older, it will be fewer eggs. Now, do we expose all those eggs to sperm and make as many embryos as we can? Or do we expose only some eggs to sperm? If we expose only some eggs to sperm, if you are a candidate, you'd have to talk this through with your physician. If you're a candidate, you could theoretically freeze other eggs, or we can discard other eggs. If you end up with more embryos than we are going to transfer into your uterus, what do we do then? We could discard them right away if you didn't want to freeze embryos. If you were open to freezing embryos, we can do that. The medical team is a fan of freezing embryos because it allows us potentially to make more embryos, first of all, and to select the best ones for transfer. And it also means if there are embryos that are left that continue to grow and develop and that look like they're good candidates for freezing, that means you have potential additional opportunities to conceive at a significantly lower cost and with much less medical intrusiveness. You could use frozen embryos if your first cycle didn't work. You could use frozen embryos if you miscarry. You could use frozen embryos 2 years from now or 4 years from now if you would like another child without doing all the IVF all over again. So medically, we're clear, freezing is a great thing, but we're aware that ethically it's very troubling for some of you. Financially, it's very challenging for some of you because insurance rarely pays for freezing. So you have to think this through in advance. Now, if you are giving the physician's consent to freeze embryos, you will have to sign a consent form in advance, which you've been given for your review. You'll have to sign a consent form that includes you giving us instructions for what to do with your embryos if you are not alive and well, and together if you're with a partner, to give us instructions. I mean, ideally, we'll never look at that consent form again. You'll make your choices as you go, and you'll do what you want to do then. But if you stop taking our phone calls or don't answer letters, or if your relationship ends, or if one of you dies, we need written instructions about what we could do with your embryos. So it's really important for you to sit down and talk about this in advance and to think it through and talk with the physician about it. Now, another area where you're going to have to negotiate with your physician and have a plan in advance is how many embryos are going to be transferred. Now, your physician's going to start with data that we have about what maximizes your chance for pregnancy and minimizes your chance of a multiple pregnancy. So they'll have a number in mind when you meet with them. You need to talk about whether you want to be more conservative for whatever reason, or whether you think you have a good argument for taking a greater risk and transferring an additional embryo. If you're going to try to change the physician's recommendation, you have to go in there being really informed and recognizing that transferring fewer embryos than your doctor recommends may decrease your chance of success, and transferring more embryos may increase your chance of a multiple pregnancy. And this is the hardest conversation we have with our patients, because most of you are thinking one of two things. You're either praying for a twin pregnancy, because if you had two kids, especially if it was a boy and a girl, you'd be good to go and you wouldn't need to do this again. Others of you are thinking, listening to me or listening to the doctor talk about this, and you're thinking, have we mentioned we can't get pregnant? And you want me to worry about being too pregnant? So this is a hard thing to get folks to worry about, but it's really quite important. And a physician especially is not going to consider transferring any additional embryos unless it's very evident to them that you totally get it. Your argument for doing so might be, for example, that you have to pay out of pocket for your treatment and you've had to beg, borrow, and steal to get here, and you really are willing to take a chance because it's so important to you that this first treatment work. But you need to then also be able to say, and we've talked about what would happen if we had a multiple pregnancy. We've talked about whether we would consider selective reduction. We've talked about whether both our mothers could move in and help us if we had three babies. So you would need to be very informed in order to have any chance of being persuasive. But one additional reason I think it's very important for you to talk this through with your each other and then with your doctor in advance is that the final recommendation for how many embryos to transfer is not made until the morning of embryo transfer, because the doctor and the embryologist are interested in looking at the quality of the embryos that have been produced. And so sometimes they'll come out, for example, and suggest, I know we talked about just transferring two, but their quality is a little bit less than we'd hoped for, and there is a third embryo, and what would you think about transferring three? Or you might have said in the beginning, we want to be very conservative. We want to the extent possible, erase any possibility of a multiple pregnancy. We only want to transfer one. So that might be your plan going into it. And on the morning of embryo transfer, the recommendation might come down that looks like we would recommend two. It's my recommendation that you decide in advance whether you would allow any change to the plan. And this is something you can decide in advance. On the morning of embryo transfer is no time to make a decision. You're nervous, you're anxious. About half of you ladies will have taken Valium on your way in that morning, and you'll think anything the doctor says is brilliant, potentially. You'll be in a little hospital coat in one of those circumstances where it's hard to be assertive, a hospital gown. It's hard to be assertive when you're the patient and you're half undressed. So this is really ideally something that you will talk about in advance, and partners or whoever you bring with you, especially if you're doing this on your own, somebody will come with you. They need to be able to say, nope, this was discussed. The plan is for one, or the plan is for two. We're not transferring anymore. It's really up to you. If you want to take the advice that's given on the day, you can take it, but ideally you will have considered it in advance. I work with several people every year who end up being more pregnant than they ever planned on being, primarily because they took the advice on the day, even though it really wasn't what they had planned to do. Because it's very hard to say no to doctors in white coats. So if you haven't rehearsed it and planned it, chances are you'll just go with the flow. So think about all of this in advance. And then finally, we want all of you to consider whether you would allow ICSI to be done if it is deemed necessary. ICSI, just to remind you, is intracytoplasmic sperm injection, where individual sperm are selected and injected into individual eggs. Many of you will have decided in advance we are doing this, either because you have male factor infertility, or sometimes physicians will recommend it for those with unexplained infertility, particularly if you've already done an IVF and fertilization wasn't strong. But some of you will go into this expecting not to need ICSI. You have good sperm analyses, your sperm reports have always been good, the doctor hasn't suggested it. We are still asking you in advance, what if on the day when you produce a sperm sample, it doesn't come up to your usual standards? What if you had the flu 3 days before? You might produce a very poor quality sperm sample, and it might be that the physician would want to do ICSI at that time. We'd like you to think about this in advance. Again, real informed consent doesn't happen under pressure or duress. It happens when you have a chance to think about it. So if we end up recommending that it be done, would you be open to that? So your consent forms will also ask for that. There will be a place where it can indicate we're gonna do ICSI, and then there will be a place where you can indicate ICSI is allowable if necessary, but only if necessary. And on the day, the physician would always talk with you about it. You'd know, but you wouldn't be starting your thinking if you've done some thinking in advance. So those are most of the things I wanted to ask you to think about as you prepare for your IVF. You can see that this is exciting and scary and messy. There's lots to think about, and yet you are not alone. We work with many of you, and we have a good program. You know that we're quite successful. So we're going to do our best for you, but we will get you through it one way or the other. We will help you be successful, or we will help you cope if this isn't a process that has worked for you. You can tell us what would be helpful to you, and if we're able to accommodate, we will try to do so. Please feel free to get in touch with my office if you wanted to meet with me or meet with somebody like me. If you don't live near the health center, I can certainly make a recommendation that would be more convenient for you geographically. So good luck. We'll do our best.